Well, good morning and a warm welcome from my side to this GPP 2020 webinar on market engagement, market sounding analysis part 2. We have together with us today Leon Hombergen from Relax Waterstraat in the Netherlands, who will give us a presentation about market consultation and the experiences from a big infrastructure purchaser from the Netherlands. So, Leon, I hand over the word to you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, let's get started then. Well, welcome to the webinar about market consultation. My name is Leon Hombergen. I work in the Netherlands. And, I will introduce myself a little bit later. Let's get to the first slide about a market consultation. And first, I would like to start with what exactly is a market consultation? In this presentation, I will try to say a little bit about what a market consultation is. We'll get to why you can do a market consultation, for what reasons or what objectives you can have, and then also how to design a market consultation, how to properly prepare a market consultation, and about the execution of a market consultation, how to actually do it on the day or on the meetings itself. I do have some experience from my own. I've organized an early market consultation, a very early stage of the project of a tidal power plant. It was quite an innovative project on which we're still working in Zeeland, in the south of the Netherlands, the Brouwersdam. And actually, you can find quite some documents about that on the website I mentioned. A little bit about me. Well, my name is Leon Hombergen. I'm 45 years old. I was born in Maastricht, in the very south of the Netherlands, very close to Belgium and Germany, and exactly now I am living and based in Delft. I was educated as a civil engineer at Delft University of Technology, and I'm working as a senior advisor at Rijkswaterstaat on a special project or a special department called Market and Innovation. Besides my work at Rijkswaterstaat, I'm an assistant professor at Delft University of Technology, on which I guide graduate students in courses on procurement, and also guide them to their master's thesis. And also, and that's beside my job, I'm a board member of the Delft Board Authority. You may know that the Netherlands has quite a big task in water, as part of the Netherlands is below sea level. There's a special authority dealing with that, regionally organized, and that's a democratic institution. I'm a board member in that. We won't get into that at the moment. How to participate today? Please ask when there's unclear items, if there's something. Also, please interact when you want to know a little bit more or want to get a little bit deeper. I don't know your the skills and how the experience you already have. So please challenge me, do interact and find me. Is that okay?
Yeah, and that is okay. I would suggest that you do this after you finish your presentation. That's easier from the system. And just if I could ask you to go closer to the microphone, because sometimes we cannot hear you very well.
Oh, thanks. That's not good. I'll try to speak a little bit louder as well. And I am closer to the microphone.
Perfect, okay, thanks a lot.
Okay. So, what is a market consultation? Of course, every organization can talk to market parties anywhere. And as a private person, you can also talk to market parties. Or maybe you meet them at the club, or maybe you meet them when you have a reunion from the university or whatever. But that, of course, is not a market consultation. A market consultation is a more officially arranged dialogue with private companies from a client. And in my perspective, the client is a government body. It is pre-competitive. It means that the tender phase is not yet open. It's not part of the tender phase. It might be part of the preparation of a tender phase. It is also about fact-finding. Fact-finding how the market can be organized or what the best approach to the market can be. Very important is that whenever you do a market consultation, no official commitments are being made. It's not a place where you make contracts or where you really arrange on how to proceed and who will do what. It's still open. It's about finding solutions. It's about knowing what the market can offer, getting in touch to each other, and well, things like that. To enhance the scope and the design of the project, in the beginning and the early phase of the project, you will have to know a bit what the scope will be, and maybe you don't know exactly what market parties can offer. So the scope definition is quite important, and to check the scope, if the scope is feasible to the market, maybe it's challenging to the market, that's why you can organize a market consultation. So another thing which you can do is to enhance the process, the tender procedure, how to approach the market, what kind of an arrangement, how to challenge the market, how to select the best market parties, what quality levels you want from the market, market. And maybe another question is also the contract arrangements. And if you have a larger project, can you do the whole project in one contract on which market parties have to engage, or will you split, for example, in separate contracts? Quite difficult questions. You need a strategy about that, but you also need to have some knowledge about how the market is going. You can still do that. You can ask these open questions to the market, but no commitments will be made. Please be aware of that. Besides this, getting to know each other and exchanging knowledge and getting to know how the market is organized and how you can work together more effectively, a market consultation can have other advantages. For example, that as it's pre-competitive, before you announce the official tender, private companies are already mobilized in a more early stage. So they get to know a bit more about the project, information is already spread, and maybe they can already arrange themselves, they can do, they can follow you and think about the project themselves as well and how their approach could be. Generally, this is quite an advantage as the tender phase is quite short, so there's little time for the private companies to really and effectively arrange themselves. Another advantage is, especially if you have a meeting with all the market parties together, is that market parties have a platform to find each other, to see who's in the market and they can cooperate. And actually, that's one of the things we did as well. We really gave opportunities to market parties to meet each other and to prepare for a joint proposal to us. In this webinar, we will be talking about two-sided market consultations, which means that we really have a dialogue where also the market parties can ask questions to the client, so to us. Another kind of market consultation is that we just have written questions and a written answer. That's not really two-sided, and that's just not the kind of market consultation which we're dealing with. This is a two-sided market consultation with a dialogue. What a market consultation is not might be important as well, as a market consultation is not a panacea for a disturbed project. If you have a disturbed project or you don't know how to go ahead, this is not the solution. It may contribute a little bit to the solution, but it's really not the way forward for this project. First, you have to know the scope, challenges, and budgets of the project yourself. Of course, you can discuss, but it's not the solution. It's also not a forum to officially commit to the market. Maybe you can sense what the market is about it, if they're eager or not, or if they have enough competition for the project or for the deal flow that you are intending to do. But it's not the place to officially commit the market. So it's still open, and maybe later some parties will see how other parties may get in. It's also not a method to get cheap advice. Of course, you can get to know very important knowledge or what is in the market, or maybe yes, new technologies in the market which you want to know about, but it's not the method to get cheap advice. If you do that, if you really consider it to be like that, later you will find that market parties will not attend your meetings. And it's also not a way to get a better understanding of the project that you have to do yourself. You need to prepare the project by yourself first, and then later check it with the market parties. And of course, in this process, you get deeper into understanding the project. But you have to know what your goals and objectives of the project are yourself. So that is not the main way to get a better understanding of the project. Of course, it may be helpful. Okay. What are the possible deliverables of a market consultation? Well, I have here some things that are together. It may give information about an optimal scope. If in the market new innovations may be available, your scope definition is very important, as maybe some new innovations are excluded by the way that you define the scope of the project. So you have to know what kind of technologies are in the market, and normally you don't know all about it. You also may get some information about the possible contract arrangements. Is it feasible to have one big contract for your project where all aspects, all technologies, all disciplines are gathered together? Or do you think, okay, there's little competition in the market, maybe I better split the project in parts, have a better competition, you get information about how the contract arrangements could be done. Also important is to know what the feasible list of requirements. Normally, I would suggest that with the information about the project that you share with the market parties, at least there's a design list of requirements so they can react on that. Not the final one, but a design list of requirements is quite important to share. And of course, the boundary condition of the project. And well, market consultations may give a very adequate reaction to that. Of course, information about how competitive the market will be, how many people will attend the market consultation, you can sense how eager they are, and also important to get the high level of specification. Is it feasible to have functional specifications to get into detail, into the technology? That kind of information you can get. And very important, I would say, is the last one, to get to know if there's any innovations in the market, any new technology, new approaches, which might be a very good solution for your project. Very often, in my experience, you start with your project team about your project, and maybe you can develop a little bit of a black tunnel vision. Actually, we had that in my project, and we didn't think of solutions that the market had in mind. And if you don't know about the solutions the market may have in mind, maybe in your specifications, in your list of requirements or boundary conditions, they can be excluded, while in fact there might be good alternatives for your to proceed with your project. So these are the possible deliverables of a market consultation. Okay, a market consultation should be very well prepared, as you need at least, I would say, 2 months. To prepare your market consultation from the first initiation, the announcement, and the actual day on which you meet the market. You have to define a clear target. What you have in mind, what knowledge you want to have from the market parties, you have to share this in your team, in your project team. Your team has to be aligned, and you need to be on a similar level. All key players have to participate. As the market parties, they will in the day or what to your market consultation. And this for them is also important to meet the decision makers, to make all key players within your project team, and maybe the sponsor of the project or the director, make them participate and at that meeting. That's quite important. And then also, maybe you have special managers for each aspect of the project. Let them formulate their targets and questions. What are the issues on which you want to deal with the market, on which you want to have a dialogue with the market? What are the questions? And really focus on well articulated, open questions. And be sure that the targets for the market consultation have to be feasible or reasonable. You won't get a total financial arrangement on the market consultation. You won't get a total overview on technologies which are on the market. But you might get a better glimpse, a better idea of what is feasible. So again, it's not a way to get a cheap advice, but to get an overview of what the possibilities and the impossibilities in the market may be. This is quite a process on which you have to spend, well, my team, we spend two times half a day to really make this clear and to engage the world team and align them for the market consultation. That's quite important. Another important thing is to compile a consultation document. The consultation document, which you will use in the announcement, you will have to together confirm and select information about the project. Maybe there's already some studies, maybe there's already some decisions which are being made from decision documents. You have to compile them or list them and make them available in the consultation document. And then again, it's a little bit about the balance. It shouldn't be an overflow of information. It's not like the more the better it is. Very often projects have already a very long stadium before it was even defined as a project. Don't get all information. If people want to do that, they better find it on the internet. Information is sufficient. Please select information and take care that it's confirmed information. It should also be open information. So the project, all the information has to be made available to any party. So it's classified, or it's not really open, you cannot use it in a market consultation. All attendants and non-attendants have to share, have to get access to these information. Of course, the goal of the consultation needs to be there. What is the target? Why do you do it? The procedure of the consultation, what steps you will take. Normally, you will have an invitation, maybe later a selection of the parties, if there's an overflow of participants. Well, you have to make sure what days things will be done and what the steps are which you are taking. We have a selection of attendance. If there's too many people who attend, well, you have to make a ranking or you have to select them. And the way that you do that, you don't have to totally say how do you do it, but you have to get an idea of if it has to be done, how you will select the attendances. It's not a competition, it's not a tender procedure, so you don't have to do that in full detail. But you have to say, okay, if there's an overflow information, maybe we need a large company or a selection of large and small companies. Also, you need well articulated questions. I already referred to that before. The articulated questions which you have to ask to the companies. Formulate those questions together with key players in your project team. That's quite important that you really. That they give their questions very often. Given their questions, you need to work on it together to articulate them quite well to make them feasible and reasonable. And they need to have also the right expectations of what can be the result of the market consultation. Another topic, if you really ask a lot of effort to your market parties to participate. You might give them a compensation, you might have to pay them. I would not easily do that, but if you really have full sessions, you might consider that. In my experience, we don't do it. And then important, the follow-up. What will be done with the results? You have to share the results, you have to publish it on a website, you have to share that and tell them what you will do with it. And normally they'll say, okay, you consider it, you will make a decision document to the director or the sponsor of the project. Another part of preparation is that you have to really announce it. It's not an official announcement as a tender procedure, but well, we've chosen to do it in a similar way as we announce our tenders. And in the Netherlands, we have a special website for that. The government is announcing its tenders. That's, well, it's mentioned here, www.tendernet.nl. You might announce it in business papers. Of course, in your own network, maybe you already know some companies or people in companies who work there. You can attend them and ask them if they will participate. A very good approach is also to ask your brand organization. Maybe the institute or engineers, maybe the contractors associations. Approach them and invite them. And it might be very good not only to invite companies through them, but also to invite branch organizations on themselves, as they can attend the meeting, and also to all the, you have a kind of independent supervisor to your market consultation, and they can inform other parties that, okay, it was really proper market consultations, we've been there, and no commitments were made, no secret information, classified information was given. So the level playing field after the market consultation is still there. We did that, and it was one of our success factors, but also the branch organization. And of course, you might have to consider an international announcement that maybe parties from other countries can participate for. If you do all that, or maybe you get an overflow of participants, of course that's part of you rather have an overflow of participants than only few participants, but if it's really too much, you might have to know how to select the parties. Maybe a good approach is to select them on past experience, or maybe by a short introduction why they want to participate and what they will offer you or what they will share with you at the consultation. I need a little break for a cup of coffee. Okay. The preparation. The features of a well-organized market consultation is that it is open and transparent. It should, well, of course, not be a hidden agenda, but you have to make a way of outcome, what your target will be, how you will see, what your objectives are. Because only if you have an open and transparent approach, and that's not only how you officially arrange it, but that's also the atmosphere that you create, market parties will be willing to share their position and their knowledge about what you're pursuing and how you will kind of find your project. It needs to be open and transparent. And of course, the meeting itself, if you have a meeting, it should be smooth, professionally organized. It's to get to know your organization, and of course, everybody better wants to work for an organization that is well organized than an organization where doesn't seem to be organized too well. Important is also the high timing in the project. Not too late, and everything is already gathered. You only need the confirmation of all the decisions that you already done, but also not too much in the beginning. Actually, you don't have an understanding of the project yourself. And the timing in the project, of course, reflects also in the level of questions that you ask. In the beginning of the project, the questions that you have will be more searching, And if you do it in a later stadium, it might be more confirming. But then again, if you have questions, the proper answer could also be that the level of specification that you have is not adequate. And then really pay special care to those remarks. If it's non-confirming, the response you get, that is very worthwhile. And then you can rearrange your project, get a better market participation. Important again, and I really say that again and again, is that all information shared is open. Not only the participants can have that information, but also the non-participants. And no binding statements are being made. It's really about getting to know a better understanding of each other. Okay, if we go further, pictures of a well-organized market presentation. Important later is that you have a well-compiled report, which you really get an idea of what happened in that market presentation. And it's, the report is not only for all attendants, but also for non-attendants. Private parties, companies, which for whatever reason did not participate in the market consultation, but later want to have a similar level of information. For them, it's really important. We try to do our best to make such a report that when you read the report, you really have the idea that you could have been there yourself as well. So the participation may not disturb the level playing field too much. Of course, if you've been there, if you've not been there, you know a bit more. Well, that's just all in the game. But the participation should not really disturb the level playing field. Well, of course, the finding and results have to be there, recommendations from the participants, and notes of the discussion. We really put quite some effort to make notes of all the discussions we have. I'll get to that later. If you really want to have a report that people will read, of course, we need some photographs with cartoons. On the right-hand side, you see a cartoon that we really shared with all participants in our project. What we also did is to ask a journalist to give his response to the meetings that we had. We had a colophon or special history from his behalf, an important list of attendance, who was there and who was not there. The last one is quite important as well. Okay, then features of a well-organized market consultation as well. Do not create an overflow of effort that is needed to participate. And effort is both time or money or staffing that is needed from the private companies. And then again, it's important to have well articulated questions which are to the point. And in my project, actually, we had too many questions on several fields, and we suggested to the market parties, we said, okay, we think that it would cost you about 1 or 2 days in preparation for the team, and please select the questions on which you want to focus. And we trusted the market party that they would give a reasonable response to the question, which actually they also did. Trust is a very important part of a market consultation. You have to trust each other, you have to have a feel-good factor that you share information. Well, we already discussed compensation. You have to pay the market parties to participate. Compensation, in my view, is not necessary, but it is important to be a good host. Actually, we have my project. We did a 2-day session. The first day, we had first a little cup of coffee. And then, in a bus, we went to the site itself. We had a tour around the lake, which was the main problem in our project. And with all the market parties, we've been traveling around. We also spoke to some of the stakeholders to share that information, which was a very good way to share information with them, to get to know them, and also to get to know each other with us. So that was a kind of feel-good factor. We already get to know each other a little bit. There were no, it really had to be, for us it was, that we wanted to be a good host, to get to know each other. And on day two, we had the market consultation themselves. Then we really had the discussions. But already before that, we presented ourselves as a good host, which actually gave us quite some good credits in the market. And in fact, what you do is it doesn't cost too much, and it's helpful to get a proper position of your project. Then the design of the process. You can do it several ways. There's really not a blueprint on how to officially do that. You have to do it, see how you can do that in the project itself. We started with the announcement that we were wanted to do the market consultation on the sites which I already gave to you, PandaNet, and maybe some business papers. We had first started with a written run, so any party could respond to the questions we asked. And to us, that was a little bit of a challenge as well, as we knew there were quite some people, also private people, who had their own ideas about the project. We didn't know how many people would respond. It would be only professional parties, or also some retired professionals or whatever. It was really open. We had to make a selection later, but this written round, everybody could see it. And after that, of course, after the written round, we had a selection of parties which would participate in the meetings and so on. We really fought it well over on how to select the parties. We did that, okay, we need a minimum level turnaround of your company, kind of professional. You need to have done similar projects before. In the end, we didn't need those criteria. Then the meeting day of the consultation itself. Well, we already said that we had a kind of team meeting, a bus tour around the site, that we had a site visit, and we already saw everything. On the day itself, we had a plenary introduction and presentations about the project, in which we could also see that the key players were involved. And in our case, it were not only the directors, but also the politicians who would have to decide about the project. They were not there themselves, but we made some recordings, as otherwise we would have to get quite some politicians together, which was not available in the agenda. That we made a small video paper in which they welcomed all participants. Quite important also, not too long, only 2 or 3 minutes for each one of those politicians, but quite important to have those key players show their commitment to the project. And after that we had round table discussions. Actually we had about 60 participants. Which is too much for plenary discussion. Of course, we had a little bit of a plenary discussion, but we formulated some issues with which the questions were contributed to. And we had an external chairman for each one of those tables. We had 10 tables, if I remember well, an external chairman, an assistant from the project, who was assisting and helping the chairman, and we had students from Delft University, as well, you remember, I also work at Delft University, who also made the notes on those round table discussions. It's important that this external chairman and the assistant from the project, that they prepare those round table discussions, both in how to do it, what questions first, what questions later, that they know each other and that they have good interaction, and that questions to the attendant, to the participants, are open. And you have to control each other on that. And in my experience, I was very happy to have those students in there as well, as they played an important role, as well, students can be biased. Maybe they have a lack of information, but also they can ask some good questions, and they can repair, they can help prepare those roundtable discussions. And my perspective was really even better as some chairman for really, well, from quite some important people in or around the project. And they really, well, there was a good chemistry between them, the stopman and the students. And that was essential to have proper round table discussion. And later, at the end of the day, we had a plenary feedback, which was shared in. And not written here is maybe even more important. After that feedback, we had drinks. Of course, you want to be a good host, but maybe also later you want to have a private chat with people. You need a little bit of networking, and the drinks afterwards are of utmost importance. And at least take an hour for that. And if people, what actually happened in my experience is that we had round table discussions of about an hour. We had 3 or 4 of them. People were really tired of that, but they stayed at the drinks because they really felt like good work was being done and they wanted to have a last chat with the group. Well, rules, important. Make clear that you have a high level of communication. There needs to be a good chemistry. No binding statements are being made. And that also means that it's not important who exactly said something. If there's no personal or commitments being made, or no commitments from a company being made, if you want to know what things are generally important in the market. So do not take note of the participants personally, but you want to know maybe a builder said this, or an architect said this, or things like that. It's not important exactly what company said something. That means they are a little bit more open in sharing their information and insights of how to participate in the project. We shared that in the communication, there's a kind of level of information which above levelable, above water, everybody can see that. And there's also information which they won't show, the underwater information. Maybe they have some special features, some new technologies, which they will not share in this pre-competitive phase. That's not bad, that's just all in the game, but just be aware that they may not directly say what is important to them. If they have a new technology, they don't want their competitors to know about them. If they have a special approach, maybe a design solution, they won't share that with their competitors. But in another way, they may give you some guides what is important for their new approach. That's the information underwater. Don't try to get this underwater information here. You can get that in a later stage at bilateral talks. And I think that's also in one of the later slides. Okay. The theoretical framework, again, important. Maybe you know a little bit about the asymmetry of information in the principal agent theory. Don't be ashamed that as a client you don't have a full information of what the project or what is feasible in the project. And the principal agent theory tells you that especially with integrated contracts, you know what you know that the builder or the contractor has a better knowledge of the project than yourself. And that's quite logical. The thing is on how you have to deal with it. And well, the principal agent theory is a kind of theoretical background to this issue in the market consultation is one of the solutions. The stewardship theory, a little bit different theory, is dealing with the same dilemma. Okay, this was the theoretical rule. Not in the slides, I see that maybe we had the market consultation itself, which was a full day. And then drinks. And then later we said, okay, if you want to give us some more information, you can have bilateral talks. We'll take an hour for that. We will take an hour for that. That's a meeting which no notes will be made. We will share the results though, and maybe if you want to share some information which you do want to share with us, but not with your competitors, if you don't want to say it, it's on the table here. So you can share that with us. So we get to know a little bit more, we have a better understanding why a special issue, why a special opening in the list of requirements, or why boundary conditions can be important to you. And then you need to have a trustful relation, you need to know each other that, okay, we will get to know this information, we will understand why it's important for you, but actually we will forget the technology or the information itself that you share with us, but we get to know why something is important to you, and we will take that in mind when we formulate the scope of the project and the level of specification. Okay, why companies cooperate? Not because they are getting paid. That shouldn't be the reason for that. It's not a business thing. But quite important for them is to get a better relation with the client, a better understanding to each other. You need to get to know each other a bit better. There needs to be they want to be in touch with you. They want to understand you, what's really important. So that's important. Another thing is that it contributes to a better, more feasible project also for themselves. Of course, it's always better to work in a project which really develops well, where you have a good result, which later you can show to other clients that you work there and you can be proud. So that's generally people want to work on, to contribute to a better, more feasible project. Another thing is that we have a fair contribution of risk and chances. Not too complicated risk of being given to the market, and that there's good chances for the markets as well to contribute to this project and maybe to make a better profit. There's nothing wrong with a good profit if there's really a better quality in your work. But they won't show their winning cards. They won't show, say, okay, when we really have the tender procedure, how we will approach you and what we will deliver. That's in a later stage. Okay, some practicalities. Take special care of good chemistry, good atmosphere, and proper catering. Very important to catering as well. There's no coffee available. You won't have people in their comfort zone, and people won't really share the information with you. Essential, do not underestimate this. But when we start with a keynote speaker, maybe a politician or a director, they have to show their commitment, important as well. And a clear program, also a clear timetable, and some rules which are already shared with you with the underwater. Well, what we did is the dialogue roundtable, the topic, more rounds, so they do not really have to be on all issues. Exactly, we had I think 10 tables. They couldn't attend all tables. They had to make a selection. We had 3 or 4 rounds. Of course, they could come there with a colleague, and they could make a plan on what table to attend. An external chairman for these round tables, quite important. An assistant from the project to make notes. And, well, I thought we had students participating in that, which was really good for the atmosphere. And make notes of the recordings, but not recordings themselves. It's not that you really want to quote people personally. And drink afterwards, already mentioned, because the process actually really there continues. Okay, some other particularities. Yes, badges with names, so you know each other. We have colors on the key cards, on the names, and each color indicated whether you are a builder or a person from the project itself, or maybe a consultant. Quite important to get a better feeling and also to be open and transparent. Make clear who works on behalf of the client, who is in the project team. To have some external guests. I already told you we had some people from the branch organization, which also reported about that in the magazine. Very short message, but quite important to have it and be clear about the follow-up. Okay. Then later the bilateral talk, no tapes, only the results will be reported, only the above water information, and well, what were our possible results, adjustments in scope or process. Actually that was essential in our project as we really changed our project because we got some eye openers from the market party to say, okay, why do you have this perspective or that perspective? If you have another perspective, maybe the project will get more feasible. So in our project, it was quite essential. But make sure that only the results, that you share the formulation of the result, and only that result is being shared with the market. Resume, market consultation, it's not part of your competition, again and again, I say that it's pretty competitive. Not part of the procurement, and the level playing field may not be really be disturbed. Of course, things will change a little bit by organizing a market consultation, but you have to do your best not to disturb the level playing field to those who are not attending it. Or maybe we will later get a view of the perspective of the project and will participate later. Information has to be open, transparent, a clear objective has to be made in advance, and no commitments are being made at that floor. It's also important to, I guess, this high chemistry over there. If you want people to be a bit in their comfort zone, to know each other, to be open, and to tell maybe a little bit more than they intended to do, if you want to know what they have in mind. But you don't have to tease them too. Well, that's my information. I don't know, maybe there are some questions from the people who've been listening all the time.
First of all, thanks a lot, Leon, for this very rich presentation and this GPP 2020 webinar. I think so much insight and knowledge on market engagement I have not seen before. It was really great that you gave this to us. Dear attendees, you have the possibility to raise your hand and then place a question. Next to your name, you should have a hand. Oh, there's the first question coming. Simon.
Hello, Simon.
I have a bit of a problem with the muting, I think. My name is Simon Clement, and I work together with Philip at ICLEI, and I'd like to echo that this was a really very good presentation from our point of view. We are approached by public authorities an awful lot who are very unsure about the procedures of market consultation. And I guess you're aware that for many, one of the key concerns relates to the legal question. So knowing what the barriers are, how far they can go. And at the crux of this seems to me to really relate to this, the underwater information that you're talking about and these bilateral meetings. And I'm still struggling a little bit to see where the barrier is. You can have bilateral meetings with individual suppliers. You're not making notes of this. You don't keep any kind of record of what's actually said there, but it could potentially impact on how the tender is then published and the results, therefore, of the tender. How do you see the legal issue there? Because I would have understood if you wanted to do something like that, you would have to provide some sort of clear information about why.
Yeah, of course, that has to be done. Actually, on the websites which are given here, you can find how we actually reported about that. We made clear to which parties we had this talk. So there's listings of the parties that we spoke to, and the results not by party, but the results are being mentioned. But indeed, there's no recordings. Well, we have recordings. No, we don't have records, but we have notes of those talks ourselves. But we do not share them in the presentation. That might be some private information, but we have that in the paper box. It is a little bit about making getting into those bilateral talks a well organized way, that also those private parties should be aware that they should not give full detail of all information. It's indeed a good issue. We reported about it. We asked them to say, okay, what is important for you to make a feasible project out of that? Don't really tell us what technology is important, but tell us why it is important. But you know, on the other hand, in this way it was quite well organized. People know who talked to whom, and those talks can be done actually everywhere. Here it was officially arranged, but maybe there's also some people who talk about the project in clubs or in a political party or wherever. So there's information being shared everywhere. Here it was officially arranged. Here we have notes about it. Everybody can see who we talked to, what the results of it is. And we got a good response from it, also from the people who were not in the project. But you have to be keen on that. And I don't have the handbook on how to exactly do that. In my perspective, if you show the participants and the non-participants that you really do your best not to share that information, that you make sure that it's well organized, it's okay. But if your organization itself is not smooth, if you say, hey, do you really want to say this to me? No, then you don't get the trust of the party. Does that answer your question?
It does. Thanks very much. I think, in a lot of cases, it's simply public authorities, it might be helpful for them to see how others are doing it somehow, because I think this is a bit of a case of feel your way into the experience, and for many this is something rather new and alien, and it would take some time to learn how it should be carried out. I think one question that was raised in the meeting that we've just come back from in Rome was about a specific market engagement process that was carried out on IT products. And there the response apparently from the suppliers was to say, no, we can't achieve these performance standards that you're asking for. But privately, through different channels, the procurer discovered that in fact these suppliers could easily meet those standards, but they didn't want the procurer to be setting ambitious requirements within the tender. And the case was that there were a very rather limited number of suppliers in the market who effectively were controlling that market. Have you encountered an issue like this, and can you think of any ways that can be dealt with, any form of solution for that sort of situation?
Yeah, no, we haven't. Actually, I would say that you really have to, if you feel that such an issue is there in the market, maybe the market consultation is not the best approach, or you need another design of the market consultation, and to tease them, say, okay, what is acceptable or not? And maybe in a special design of a round table, you could challenge the market a bit more. But I have no experience exactly in that field. So I wonder if really a market consultation would be a solution to that problem.
Okay, thanks a lot, Simon and Leon, for this. Are there any further questions? Please raise your hand. If not, then I would have one, Leon. you mentioned that those processes simply need time also beforehand. 2 months, you said, for the preparation. And is this really realistically 2 months only? I had the feeling.
Well, that's a good one. Well, we did it in 2 months, and that was quite a challenge. As we had first written around, well, we had the announcement, which already took quite some time to compile the document. Then we had the written round, and then we had the full consultation itself. And we needed the information early, as we needed to make some decision or decision-making process, so we rushed. But we maintained the quality level of the meetings themselves. So we had, well, we rushed, but we in that rush we had to think of, okay, what do we want? We need to assure the quality level. I would say 2 months is quite quickly. If I would have to do it again, I would take 1 more month. And if you take even more time, maybe it doesn't enhance quality, because it needs to be on your focus when you organize it. It needs to be on the top of your things to do list. It's not a thing which is just a side product in your project. In your project. So you need to, it needs to get proper attention in your project team as well. So okay. I said 2 months. I did it in 2 months. I had some sleepless nights, actually.
Okay.
There's too many things you have to organize that. Well, maybe now I could do it more easily, but if I would make my own planning, I would take about 3 months. Yes.
Okay, that's a good point. What did your legal people say to the whole process? So your legal department.
We engaged them in the design of this process, so they really they helped us. Now I must say that we had a kind of perfect legal expert who is not too afraid to take some risks. But who is also very highly people know his knowledge and he's very well known. And we had him on stage as well to tell the participants about the rules of the market consultation, which was a bit helpful. People, he's a kind of high shot in the market, people trust him, and he was connected to us, and he made the rules, he showed in 5 or 10 minutes on the stage in the plenary part, he presented the rules. And people, as he was engaged, people said, okay, if he's engaged, we know it's organized in a proper way. So that was helpful as well.
Oh, that sounds very good. So basically you had him on stage, displayed, shown commitment, and it fits well what you said earlier also, that a keynote speaker opens this and shows also the commitment of the company and the backup, basically. Also,
it's a lawyer who both works for us and sometimes another company, another project for private parties, and he has a very high reputation, and well, he wasn't included in the design of our project. Actually, if you have a look on our site, you will find those preparation documents, which also in English as well. And the process is there as well, and it was designed for this lawyer.
So it's the first web link, this getiludenzentrale.brouwersdam.nl?
Yeah, the Getijdencentrale.brouwersdam, but more easy is, well, it's an abbreviation. KCBD, PCBD.nl. There you can find the information. It looks like there's only one side. Actually, it's two sides. The other side is www.pcbd.nl. I saw some other small faults in the presentation. I think I didn't use the final presentation. So I don't know if you can share this presentation later with all attendees.
Yeah, that would be lovely if you could send it to me, the presentation, and then I will make sure that it will be shared. So thanks a lot again, Leon. If there would not be any further questions, then I would close this webinar and would just let you know we have recorded this. It will be shared on the GPP 2020 website, which is gpp2020.eu. You will find also more information on the project, for instance, about which tenders are currently open on our website. So this is all the open tenders that we have. They get regularly updated, for instance, within 1 week now. And also, yeah, I would like to say to you, enjoy a good rest of the day and a good and relaxing weekend. Thanks a lot to you.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Okay, bye-bye.
Goodbye. Bye.